ancient myths to Marvel comics, Shakespeare to sitcoms, dystopia to Disney, fairy tale to real life, at the center of the story, we often find the hero.
Superheroes. That's one genre of hero that immediately comes to mind. After all, they can do things no normal person can, stand against forces the rest of us can't even hope to combat, represent the ideals of our society, even if they're ideals we've forgotten ourselves, and they act as a beacon for the rest of us.
Sometimes superhero drama comes from their need to see justice. Sometimes it's the need to protect that the hero holds dear. Sometimes the struggle that comes with suddenly being thrust into a mantle of great power and the enormous responsibility that comes with it.
But even superheroes have their fatal flaws and very human ones.
Welcome everyone to the very first super official superhero support group meeting. To lighten the little tension that we have, do you know why I couldn't wear skinny jeans to this meeting?
Why?
Because I can never pull them up. Get it? Pull it off. Not only the style, but the jeans themselves. But I know that some of you have come great distances, and I admire that. In fact, just today, I learned where some of our finest superheroes and sidekicks have come from. Why, Cape Town, of course! All right, now that we're all relaxed, I know that it's not easy to open up in front of a group of strangers, but we're all here for around the same reason. I mean, we all have at least one thing in common, right? Superpowers, of course.
Yeah.
Is there anyone willing to introduce themselves, stand up, say their name, start us off for the evening? Anyone? Please? Oh, what about you, Hawkeye, the guy with the bow and the arrow. So cool. Loving your costume, by the way. For as they say, time flies like an arrow, but fruit flies like bananas.
I'm Hawkeye from Marvel Comics, one of the Avengers. My power is archery, and yeah, I like being a superhero, but it's all cracked up to be. Dedicating yourself to an ideal, the physical toll it takes on your body, risking your life at its moment's notice, knowing that if you mess up, it literally could be the end of the world. That's the easy part. I mean, that's what we live for, right? The rush you feel when you defeat a villain, the thrill of shooting that perfect arrow, and there's nothing, I mean nothing, better than saving the world. It's after that. The downtime, the regular stuff, going to the gym, catching up on your paperwork, taking out the trash, all the boring stuff that you find boring, we find really, really boring. Imagine, you're fighting a clone army, jumping off buildings, firing exploding arrows, and just when you think you saved the day, you find a bomb. A nuclear end the world bomb. And guess what? There's only 30 seconds left until it goes off. So you do your best to dismantle it, but you're just guessing because you've never done this before. You're quickly cutting wires, green, then blue, then green again. 10, 9, 8. It should be working, but it's not. 7, 6, 5. Oh man, I didn't train for this. 4, 3, 2. And then a split second decision, you reach in, pull out a handful of wires, and it works. It really shouldn't have worked, but it worked. There's 1 second left. You're thinking, you're the man, Hawkeye, whoa. You actually pulled that off, saved the day. Let me tell you, there's nothing like that rush. And the next day, you're folding laundry. You're just a guy with a bow and arrow folding laundry. It drives a guy nuts. So you spend the next day walking around searching for that disaster, that rush of seeing someone in danger so you could save them, but it never comes. It's enough to drive a person crazy.
I hear you, big guy. I don't need a mood ring to tell me how that makes me feel. But
In mythology, which is at the heart of all hero stories, there is an order of events outlined in the hero's journey, starting with the call to adventure. Very often, it's the ordinary character in an ordinary world who is called to serve humanity. This sometimes sudden push out of a character's comfort zone is known as the inciting incident.
Consider Katniss from the Hunger Games, waiting with all of District 12 for the reaping, when participants will be picked to be in the Hunger Games. When her sister's name Primrose is called, Katniss's moment arrives. The injustice of her own world becomes terrifyingly personal, and she must step up.
Sometimes, after the hero's call, they have serious second thoughts and may even outright refuse the call altogether. In the Disney classic, The Lion King, Simba was blamed for his father Mufasa's death and exiled from his homeland by his treacherous uncle Scar. Time passes and Simba grows into an adult lion, and his old friend Nala finds him. Surprised that they discover each other after all this time, she tells him that they thought he had died and now Scar has left. The hyenas take over Pride Rock, and that they need Simba to claim his place as king in order to save them.
We really needed you at home. No one needs me. Yes, we do. You're the king.
Nala, if we've been through this, I'm not the king. Scar is.
Simba, he let the hyenas take over the Pride Lands.
What?
There's no food, no water. Simba, if you don't come back soon, everyone will starve.
I can't go back.
Why?
You wouldn't understand.
What wouldn't I understand?
No, it doesn't matter. Hakuna Matata.
What?
Hakuna Matata, it's something I learned over here. Look, sometimes bad things happen. Simba. And there's nothing you can do about it, so why worry?
Because it's your responsibility.
Well, what about you? You left?
I left to find help and I found you. Don't you understand? You're our only hope.
Sorry.
What's happened to you? You're not the Simba I remember.
You're right. I'm not. Now are you satisfied?
No, just disappointed.
You know, you're starting to sound like my father.
Good, at least one of us does.
Listen, you think you can just show up and tell me how to live my life? You don't even know what I've been through.
What if you just tell me?
Forget it!
Fine!
Simba eventually comes around when he sees the ghost of his father within himself, and he knows that he must fulfill his destiny. Simba, well, he's not the only reluctant hero.
This is our most desperate hour. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
You must learn the ways of the Force if you're to come with me to Alderaan.
Alderaan? I'm not going to Alderaan. I'm going to get home. It's late. I'm in for it as it is.
I need your help, Luke. She needs your help. I'm getting too old for this sort of thing.
So I can't get involved. I've got work to do. It's not that I like the Empire. I hate it, but there's nothing I can do about it right now. Such a long way from here.
That's your uncle talking.
Oh, God, my uncle. How am I ever going to explain this?
Learn about the Force, Luke.
Now, look, I can take you as far as Anchorhead. You can get a transport there to Mos Eisley or wherever you're going.
You must do what you feel is right, of course.
My proposition's this. Would you be interested in fighting Apollo Creed for the World Heavyweight Championship?
No.
Listen, Rocky. Apollo's seen you fight. He likes you. He wants to fight you.
Well, it's just that you see, I fight in clubs, you know, and I'm really a ham and egg. This guy, he's the best, and it wouldn't be such a good fight, but... Thank you very much, you know, I appreciate it.
Rocky, do you believe that America is the land of opportunity?
Yeah.
Apollo Creed does. And he's going to prove it to the whole world by giving an unknown a shot at the title. And that unknown is you. He picked you, Rocky. Rocky, it's the chance of a lifetime. You can't pass it by.
Let's face it, the hero is emotionally fragile. Even if they keep a bold exterior, we know it's a mask. At least at the beginning. After setting off on their journey, they will face uncertainty, they will be tested, they will experience loss. They will want to turn back, but go on they must.
High and attach onto buildings that spring from your palms, but it's because of these abilities the following has happened to me. First, my uncle died, then my first girlfriend died, then my current girlfriend I had to break up with because if she knew my true identity, she'd be constantly in danger. Oh, and every friend I make somehow turns into a supervillain and tries to kill me. Is it really that worth it?
Tell me about it, Spider-Man. It's true. I have super strength, super speed, agility, stamina, a magic sword, lasso of truth, invincible bracelets. I've also been flying since I was 12.
The ability to fly would be so uplifting. Get it? Uplifting? Anyways, Wonder Woman, what's your complaint? What brought you here today?
This costume! It looks like a 1940s bathing suit made out of an American flag. Is anybody in 2021 gonna take me seriously in this getup? Would a feminist heroine of today be wearing this? Seriously, don't you think I need some updating? But it's part of the contract. Part of the package, so to speak. It's oppressive is what it is.
Before we feel too sorry for the hero, remember, they usually have company. Often, they begin their training with a mentor, an older, sometimes magical helper, who will guide and encourage them on their quest.
Seems to me that what you folks need is a hero.
Yeah? And who are you?
I'm Hercules, and I happen to be a hero.
Is that so? Have you ever saved the town before?
Not exactly, but I...
Have you ever reversed a natural disaster?
Well, no.
He's just another chariot chaser. This we need. Don't you pea brains get it? This kid is a genuine article.
Hey, isn't that the goat man who trained Achilles?
budget, pal. Yeah, you're right. Hey, nice job on those heels. You missed a spot.
I got your heel right here. What's that freaking grin on your face you want?
Are you crazy?
Young man, we need a professional hero, not an amateur.
But wait, stop. How am I supposed to prove myself a hero if nobody will give me a chance?
And how could we forget about the hero's trusty sidekick?
Man, I like you. What's your name?
Shrek?
Shrek? Well, you know what I like about you, Shrek? You got the kind of I don't care what nobody thinks about me thing. I like that. I respect that, Shrek. You're all right. Woo, look at that. Who would all live in a place like that?
That would be my home.
Oh, and it's lovely, just beautiful. You know, you're quite the decorator. It's amazing what you've done with such a modest budget. I like that boulder. It's a nice boulder. I guess you don't entertain much, do you?
I like my privacy.
You know, I do too. That's another thing we have in common. Like, I hate when someone's all up in your face and you're trying to give them a hint and they just won't leave. There's that awkward silence. Can I stay with you?
What?
Can I stay with you, please?
What if I don't know what apocalypse means? I mean, it's not the end of the world.
Oh my god.
Okay. Who wants to be next? Remember, just because you're not one of our superheroes and one of our sidekicks doesn't make you less important. I know we have some really big sidekicks among us today. Just because you're a sidekick doesn't mean that you're a sidekick in your own life.
I'll go. My name's Richard Grayson, aka Robin, as in Batman and Robin. I've been a sidekick for 7, 11, I don't even know, I've lost count. I was an orphan and kind of alone. And then the coolest superhero ever asked me to be a sidekick? I mean, of course I said yes! One 14-year-old wouldn't jump at the chance to work with Batman! But I should have known, when he named me Robin, it was going to be a tough road. Okay, just imagine this. The meanest, toughest criminal you've ever seen, grabbing him by the collar to scream in his face, I'm Robin! Most of them laugh in my face, and I don't even blame them. A Robin just isn't scary. Even with the lame name, it was fun for a while. Staying up late, crazy weapons, saving people, working with Batman. But lately, I'm having a really hard time putting on the red, green, yellow outfit. Even though I look like a kid, I'm not 14 any longer, and I never even went to college. I'm completely unqualified for any job, and if Batman one day just decides to retire, that's it! I'm without a job! And it keeps me up at night! I'm just so tied to Batman! I want to be my own superhero, Richard Grayson. Okay, here it comes. The moment we all await. The confrontation with the villain.
That's enough! Off with their heads!
Oh, please, please, they're only trying.
Why, who is this? It's a little girl.
Yes, and I was hoping...
Look up, speak nicely, and don't twiddle your fingers. Turn out your toes. Curtsy, open your mouth a little wider and always say, yes, your majesty.
Yes, your majesty.
Now, where do you come from and, where are you going?
Well, I'm trying to find my way.
Your way? Always here are my ways.
Let's face it, our villains make our heroes. Without them, our heroes can't shine. Without the villain, good has nothing to triumph over. Nothing challenges the protagonist, and everyone just goes about their average lives. The villain keeps the action moving. They poke and prod at the protagonist, reveal the chink in the hero's armor, force them to stretch, grow, and change. Okay.
It's true. Without the White Witch, Aslan was just a recluse lion. Without Darth Vader and the Collective Empire, Star Wars would have just been about a galaxy far, far away, in which Luke Skywalker helps Uncle Owen with the harvest. Without the evil stepmother, Cinderella is just a peasant girl going to a ball and marrying her prince without any hitch. Without the Joker, Batman, well, he's just a rich dude with anger issues and too much time on his hands.
The bigger your hero, the bigger your villain must be. No one wants to see Superman take on a normal bank robber. And so, at some point in the hero's journey, the villain needs to be on top. The Joker needs to successfully blow up the hospital. Voldemort needs to regain human form. Maleficent needs to assert her magical authority.
You weren't wanted!
Not what? Oh dear, what an awkward situation. I had merely hoped it was due to some oversight. Well, in that event, I best be on my way.
And you're not offended?
Why no? And to show I bear no ill will, I too shall bestow a gift on the child. Listen well, all of you! The princess shall indeed grow in grace and beauty, beloved by all who know her. But before the sun sets on her 16th birthday, she shall prick her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel and die!
Oh no! Ha ha ha! Stand back, fool!
The villain's monologue is the moment that we all wait for. The moment that we love to hate. James Bond is tied to a table. That laser beam is slowly creeping toward him. Feeling that victory is imminent, the villain decides to reveal their master plan.
We know it's a mistake. We know the hero is going to escape, yet we still eat it up because it's such an important moment in the story. It not only raises the stakes of the conflict by giving us a glimpse into what will happen if your hero doesn't rise to the challenge, it also gives us a clear picture of what the villain's motivation is. Does he want money, power, or does she just want to watch the world burn?
See, now you expect me because I'm a threat. That's the way it works. Turns out there are a lot of people, whole countries, who want respect, and they will pay through the nose to get it. How do you think I got rich? I invented a weapon that only I can defeat, and when I unleash it, I'll get... You sly dog! You got me monologuing! It's cool, huh? 0 point energy? I saved the best inventions for myself. Who's super now? I'm Syndrome. Nemesis.
And then there's the awkwardly charming villain who, in fact, is really an unlikely hero.
Oh, me? I'm dishonest. And as a dishonest man, you can always trust to be dishonest. Honestly, it's the honest ones you want to watch out for, because you can never predict when they're going to do something incredibly stupid.
This is either madness or brilliance.
It's remarkable how often those two traits coincide. You know, I'm actually feeling really good about this. I think we all arrived at a very special place, eh? Spiritually, ecumenically, grammatically. This is the day you will always remember as the day you almost caught Jack Sparrow.
At last, the hero must face their greatest ordeal, confront their deepest fears, or perhaps even death.
But of course, they triumph over evil and claim their just reward before beginning the journey home, just to do it all over again next season.
When you think of the word hero, what comes to mind? A firefighter? A soldier? A comic book crime fighter?
In the second to last installment of the Marvel movies, Infinity Wars, a crazy alien guy causes worldwide destruction on Earth with a simple snap of his fingers that were empowered by the use of these ancient stones. His philosophy was to destroy half the population by his viral infest epidemic. The snap of his fingers and the world would be a brighter place.
Only it didn't work like that. Families were torn apart by loss and unable to hold the ones they love. Others lost their livelihoods and their homes. Some knew hunger for the first time. Life as they knew it was changed forever. Does that remind you of a current event? Only it wasn't a villain that snapped his fingers, nor was there a Marvel hero to step in and save the day. But there were and are heroes among us.
In this past year, over a year, our heroes have been the healthcare providers, EMS, nurses, doctors, therapists, social workers, and direct support personnel who have worked with the sick, the elderly, the disabled, those struggling with mental health issues, those who have lost jobs and loved ones.
Heroes have been essential workers, such as firefighters, police officers, corrections officers, food and agricultural workers, United States Postal Service workers, manufacturing workers, and grocery store workers.
Hero teachers taught hero students online as hero parents tried to balance budgets and jobs while supporting their kids' education at home.
Hero school leaders, administrators, ed techs, coaches, cafeteria workers, custodians, all worked in the front lines keeping our schools safe and our students active and learning.
Then there were the quiet volunteers who fed the homeless at soup kitchens or delivered meals to those in need. Those who did what they could, where they could.
In the words of Bill Gates, when I was a kid, my image of a hero was largely inspired by my dad's collection of early Superman comics. I read them all. A hero was somebody who had supernatural powers, like flying, laser vision, or the strength to bend steel. As humans, of course, we're all pretty limited in our physical powers. We don't fly, we can't see through walls. What is unbounded in us is our ability to see justices and to take them on, often at a great risk to ourselves.
Truth is, there is a hero that lies within each and every one of us.
My husband, Peter Parker, was an ordinary person. He always said it could have been anyone behind the mask. He was just the kid who happened to get bit.
I'm going to miss him.
Yeah.
We were friends, you know.
Can I return it if it doesn't fit?
It always fits. Eventually.
He didn't ask for his powers. But he chose to be Spider-Man. My favorite thing about Peter is that he made us each feel powerful. We all have powers of one kind or another. But in our own way, we are all Spider-Man. And we're all counting on you.
Strength to care.